So this is a slightly different topic, or quite different topic from what we have heard yesterday. So far, we have been talking about tools to analyze data sets. And in contrast, now we're going to talk about creating new artificial data sets. You may be wondering why that would be an interesting idea at all. There are two main reasons why people are interested in generating genetic data sets. And one of them you have already seen mentioned yesterday in a few talks is to generate data on which you can test new software. So from the simulation, you know what the actually true genotypes are of the individuals that have been simulated. And you can see if your software is able to reconstruct those individuals correctly. But that's interesting for software developers, but maybe not so much directly for breeders. And today I want to talk about a different application, and that is how you can use simulation software to compare different breeding and selection strategies. And how you can compare them in terms of genetic gain mainly, and also in costs or number of generations and so on. About this presentation, I will be presenting from the workshop manual vignette that you see on screen now. It's among the workshop materials. The workshop is supposed to run from R, and all the workshop materials are supposed to be in the working directory in R. There's also a file called simulationworkshop.r that contains all the commands in this vignette. So I'll be presenting two different tools. In first place, Pedigree Sim, which is software that is used to generate populations. So it will simulate the genetics of a population, which is defined in terms of pedigree with founders and all the progeny. And the second tool that I will present is called GenoSim. I'll come to that later. That's used to simulate either array data or sequencing data obtained that mimic genotyping experiment results. So first about Pedigree Sim then. Actually there are two parts. I have an R package called Pedigree Sim R, and that's used to interact with Pedigree Sim itself. Pedigree Sim program that is not a Java program. It's meant to be run from the command line. In order to work comfortably with it from R, there's this package Pedigree Sim R, which you can install using the install packages command. And if you are working on the Windows, you should use the zip file. And if you work from other operating systems, you should use the tar.gz file. And there are here some instructions what you can try also if you run into difficulties installing the package. Well, assuming that the package is installed correctly, you give the command library pedigree sim r, and that makes the commands, the functions in the package available to your R session. Well, as I mentioned, pedigree sim itself, it's not an R program. It's written in Java. And in order to run on your computer, you should have Java installed on your computer. Often that's already the case, but you can check whether it's the case with this command, checkable Java. It's one of the commands in Pedigree Sim R. And if Java is installed, you will get a few lines, like you see here, that gives some details about the Java version that is installed. And otherwise, you will have to install Java first. And then the last component that we need is Pedigree Sim itself. As I said, it's included in the workshop materials. And the only thing that is needed is to copy to copy it together with all the other workshop materials. And I assume that it's copied into the directory. So Pedigree-Sim is, it's already published in 2012, but it's still being updated from time to time. I included the current version in the workshop materials, but if you want to use it later, you can check this GitHub directory to see, to get the latest version. So the last thing we need to do is to tell R where it can find the Pedigree-Sim program file. And we do that by setting the path to Pedigree-Sim to the location. I start out with a very simple introduction with a very small example of Pedigree-Sim. And after that, in the workshop manual, there is a more extensive example, which I shall shortly describe, but I'm not going to go through it completely during this workshop because the time doesn't allow that. But it's there for you to try out if you're interested. So one thing to mention first is random numbers. So the process that are being simulated, they are composed of a lot of random events. For instance, which pollen grain pollinates an egg cell, where do the recombinations occur between chromosomes, and so on and so on. And these random processes are imitated in the computer with a random number generator. And of course, if you run the program twice, you'll get slightly different results, which is exactly what you would expect in reality. If you make the same cross twice, you will get slightly different progeny. But sometimes that's not very convenient. And the nice thing in a computer is that you can set a random seed, which is the command that's given here. And if you do that and you give some arbitrary number, then each time you run the program, you'll get exactly the same sequence of random numbers generated and therefore the same results of your simulation. Okay, that's some background. So if you set the seeds exactly like I put here, you should get exactly the same results. And otherwise you get somewhat different results, which is not bad at all. It's not a problem. But if you really want to reproduce the results in this manual, then you should use the seeds that we set in this workshop. Okay, now, in order to perform a simulation, Pedigree-Sim needs a few things. First, you have to say something about the crop, the species. For instance, what kind of genome does it have? And in this small example, we define a species that has two chromosomes that we name chromosome A and B. And of course, each of them will be present in four copies in a tetraploid. We will tell the Pedigree-Sim that both chromosomes have a length of 100 centimorgans, with the centromeres located at 20 centimorgan in chromosome A and 50 centimorgan in the other chromosome. And also, there will be no preferential pairing and no quadrivalent formation in this example. So we generate the chromosome file, which is one of the input files for Pedigree-Sim, with this set of commands. So we create a data frame with the chromosome, with columns chromosome, length, centromere, and preferential pairing, and quadrivalence. We write this to a file. The file is called a_chromosome.dat. I'll come back to this name somewhat later. And we type out the chromosomes data frame. And you can see it here, the two lines, for one for each chromosome, is the length, the centromere, the preferential pairing, and the quadrivalence. So preferential pairing and quadrivalence, these are both numbers that can vary from 0 to 1. With 0, there's no preferential pairing at all. So we have completely poly suppose. Polysomic inheritance. The other extreme is one, and then you have disomic inheritance. So that means that you would have two pairs, or in the case of a hexaplot, three pairs of chromosomes that do not pair between each other. And for quadrivalence, there's also a number from between 0 and 1. With 0, there no quadrivalents are ever formed. And with 1, all the quadrivalents that are possible are formed in each meiosis. So in a tetraploid, that would mean that each chromosome, for each chromosome, there's a quadrivalent. In a hexaploid, for each chromosome, you would have a quadrivalent plus a bivalent. And for an octaploid, would have two quadrivalents and so on. So these are the chromosomes. Then we define a genetic map, which again is a data frame with columns marker, the marker names, which are completely free to choose. They don't have any meaning for pedigrisum. The chromosome, that must be a name that is one of the names in your chromosome file, and a position. And the positions in the pedigrisum are always in centimorgans. Pedigrisum doesn't work with physical maps, only with genetic maps. So we write the map again to a file called a_map.dat. And the top of the map, I should have mentioned. So in this map, we define one locus every 10 centimorgan on each chromosome. So if we type out the map, we have here the marker names, and they are named for the chromosome on which they are, plus the position where they are. As I said, this is arbitrary. It's not necessary to give these names at all. You can choose anything else. And then there's the column is the chromosome and the position. This is the map format that's used very often, of course. Now, then we will define the population that is going to be simulated. That will be composed of a very small F1 population, so with two parents and three F1 individuals. And the founders of this population are the parents of the F1, and they are named P1 and P2. In order to simulate the genotypes for all the descendants, we need to define the phased genotypes of the founders. Now, again, you have all the freedom you like in defining the alleles and the genotypes. So loci can be biallelic or multiallelic. And the names can be anything, numbers, letters, words, whatever you like, as long as it's just one string, so no spaces or so. For this small example, we will use the alleles 0 and 1 for all the loci on the map, and we'll assign them randomly to the homologs of the parents. So we get a series of instructions. We set the ploidy to 4. The founder names to P1 and P2, and we define a founder geno as a data frame with a column marker, which is the same as the marker names in the map. And we get a matrix of 8 columns, which we are randomly assigned 0s and 1s. We write this founder genotype file to the file a_founder_geno.dat. And the head of this file looks like this. So we have a column called marker, with the marker names. And then for each individual, each founder, in this case, we have two founders, P1 and P2. And each of these founders has 4 homologs because we are working in a tetraploid crop. So we have P1, 1, P1, 2, P1, 3, and P1, 4 are the 4 homologs of parent 1. And for each locus, you see the marker that is on that position. Okay, now we have created all the input files with the input data, but we still need to create a parameter file, which actually will tell pedigrisum what it should do in this simulation run. And the parameter file contains the following elements: ploidy, 4 of course, map function that can be either Haldane or Cosambi. And actually, that means to pedigrisum whether it should simulate chiasma interference or not. So with Haldane, you will not simulate chiasma interference. With Cosambi, you will. Then we define the population as the population type is F1. There are other choices like F2, Backcross, Selfing, and population size is 3. So that means there are 3 progeny individuals. We mentioned the 3 files that we have just created, the chromosome file, the map file, and the family genotypes file. Then there's a parameter called natural pairing, which we set to false. Natural pairing, well, it's there more for historical reasons. It controls how the chromosome pairing works. If you want to use the probability of quadrivalent formation that we specified in the chromosome file, we should put it to false. And if you put it to true, we another way of, well, chromosome pairing is used, which is actually not very realistic, which I don't use anymore. Okay, and then there's the parameter output, A1. So that is the prefix to all the output files that are generated by PedigreeSim. So it serves to group those files. And well, as you may have noticed, the input files that we created so far have the underscore A. So they will be used in all simulation runs in this example. And A1 is specific for the first simulation run in this example. So now we have defined the parameters and we make a parameter file using the parameters, and we save them to a file called a1.par. I should mention there's also again a parameter seed here. PedigreeSim, as I said, is a separate program. It doesn't run under R. So the set seed command of R does not apply to PedigreeSim. And if you want to have a fixed output of PedigreeSim, you need also to set a seed for the random number generator in PedigreeSim. But you can easily leave it out. In that case, you will get a different result every time. Okay, now we have everything that we need, and we can run PedigreeSim with the commands run PedigreeSim. So we specify the parameter file, a1.par that we just created. And we also specify where to find the PedigreeSim program. And that's for this parameter we already set earlier. And then after a few seconds in this case, you get this output. So the first line of output that is generated is the name of the parameter file that's used for documentation. And all the other output is actually written on the command line, if you run the program from the command line, as soon as it occurs. And because the output files for PedigreeSim can be very big, they can take very long to be written. And it's then sometimes nice to have some visual feedback that, that something is happening at all. However, if you run it from R, as we are doing here, then the output only appears when PedigreeSim is finished. So it's in that case, all this output is not very relevant. Okay, well, assuming that there was no error, then PedigreeSim has produced some output files. In the first place, it has written a pedigree file. As you remember, we have specified the population with the keywords population type and population size. And this is interpreted by PedigreeSim as instructions to form a pedigree. And the pedigree looks like this. So you have the name of the individual and you have the names of their 2 parents. And so the first 2 individuals here are the founders, the parents. They don't have any founder, any parents within this pedigree. And so their parents are listed as not available or missing. And the 3 F1 individuals each have parent 1 and parent 2 as parents. So actually the pedigree is, you can also, instead of population type and population size, you can directly specify a pedigree file, which is a completely free and way to specify any pedigree you would like to create. Okay, then there's probably the most interesting file of the output, and that's the genotypes, the face genotypes of all the individuals that have been created. And there's a function read genotypes that reads these files. That function returns a list with three components, and the first component is called geno, and that contains the matrix of the face genotypes. So what you see here is again a layout very similar to the founder genotypes file that we defined, and actually the first eight columns are identical to the genotype file. Because, well, here we see the homologs of the two parents, so the four homologs of two parents, with the alleles that we specified at each locus. But now we also have, for each of the progeny individuals, four columns. So the progeny, if you recall, is called F11, F12, F13. And of course, after the F11, there is again an underscore 1, 2, 3, and 4 to indicate the homolog here. Usually when you perform a genotyping experiment, you do not get the face genotypes, at least not so far, but you get allele dosages, and these are returned in the allele dose file, which you can read with read allele dose, and in that case you get only one column for each individual. And it shows you the dosage of one of the alleles. And it's always the allele that has the highest value, alpha numerically speaking. So here the one allele is counted and not the zero allele, because the one is the highest. So if you just check two values here for the first marker, parent one has a dosage of 4 and parent two has a dosage of 3. If you go back to the matrix here, we see that parent 1 has 4 ones here, and parent 2 has 3 ones and 1 0. So in this way, these two files match with each other. By the way, the read genotypes function, it returned a list, as I said, with other components as well. So the geno component is the matrix of the face genotypes, but it also deduces the ploidy and the names of the individuals automatically, which can be handy. So there are quite a number of other output files, and they are all discussed in the PedigreeSim manual, which is also included in the workshop materials. One of them is the haplostruct files. The haplostruct is the name that is used in PedigreeSim to indicate a mosaic of segments of founder chromosomes. So if you have a recombination, let's say from in the first founder of between homologs 1 and 2, you would have a mosaic composed, for instance, first of a segment from homolog 2, and then a recombination point, and then a segment of homolog 1. And of course, the further you get into the pedigree, these mosaics become more extended. Well, that's what's called the haplostruct. And these files, they allow to reuse the simulated genotypes of previous simulations, and then simulate additional individuals as well, which is what we're going to see now. But first, if we want to simulate breeding and selection, it's not sufficient to simulate only genotypes. Of course, we are dealing here with traits, and traits have causal loci, at least that's the foundation of all our breeding work. So we must have a way to convert or to deduce the genotypic value of an individual from its genotype. And of course, there are many, many ways to do so. And the relation between genotype and genotypic value is not is outside of pedigree sim. It's something that that you have to specify yourself. For instance, working within R. A very simple model could be that there is one trait locus, one causal locus, and that it works in an additive way. That's more or less the simplest model that you can imagine. And that's something that we use in this small example. So we define locus A30 as the causal locus of the trait, and the number of one alleles, so the dosage, is equivalent to the trait value. So the genotypic value. And that's what happens here. We have dose, that's this array that was obtained by reading the allele dose file. And here for marker 30, A30, we have these dosages, allele dosages for all individuals. And that's what we extract here. So the genotypic value will be those numbers. And from the genotypic value, we can simulate a phenotypic value. Again, you can make that as complex as you like, but here we do it very simply by adding a small normally distributed error term to the genotypic value. So phenotypic value is the genotypic value plus the normally distributed error with a mean zero and standard deviation, in this case, 0.5. So we can show them side by side. The genotypic value is here. So these are actually the allele dosages at this locus A030. And the phenotypic values are shown here. So now if we are talking about selection, in this case we would perform selection based on the phenotypic values. And for some reason, we would like to cross the best of the two parents with the best of the three progeny. So how do we do that? So we get the best parents by looking at the phenotypic values of the two parents and selecting the one that is the highest. And similarly, we select the best F1 individual by looking at the phenotypic values of the three F1s and select the one with the highest. And so the best ones that have been selected in this way are P2 and F11. And if you look back to the phenotypic values, you see that that's correct. So P2 has a higher value than P1, and F1 has a higher value than the other two F1s. Now, then we have selected the two individuals that we want to cross, and we have to add their progeny to the pedigree. So this is a BC1 progeny with those two parents. And we define a new pedigree as a data frame where the name is BC1 underscore and the number 1 to 4. Parent 1 is the best P and parent 2 is the best F1. And we add this new pedigree to the existing pedigree. What's happening here? And we write that to a file called a2.pet, because it will be used in the second simulation run of this example. And we print it out and we see that we had the first 5 lines are the 5 individuals that we already had. Now we have 4 new individuals with the 4, each time with parents P2 and F11. So we go on and simulate the genotypes of those 4 new individuals. But of course, we want to keep the old genotypes of the old individuals, because otherwise we would just simulate everything again. And then it could happen that now P1 would be the best parent instead of the P2. So a way to keep the old individuals is to specify the haplostruct that I was mentioning earlier as one of the parameters. So if we look at the new parameter file that we create, it has a few things that are the same. Of course, the ploidy remains the same. The map function remains the same. We have now a new pedigree file, a2.pet, with the 4 new individuals. The chromosome file and the map file and the founder file, they remain the same. Natural pairing remains the same. The haplostruct, so here we specify the prefix that was used in the first run. So the HappoStruct files that were output in the first run were now input for the second run. And the new output files from the second run will get the prefix A2. And we again specify a seed for the random number generation, Rita. We again make a parameter file, also called A2.par. And we run pedigree sim again, just as we did before. And we get a similar output with the first line now mentioning parameter file A2.par. And then we calculate the genotypic value of the individuals, also as we did before. We read the allele dose file of the second run. The genotypic values are the dosages at locus A30, as before. And we have a look at the genotypic values. So what we see here, and you have to believe me, the first five individuals have exactly the same genotypic value as they had before, which is as it should be, because if all is well, those five individuals still have the same genotypes. Yeah, they have not been changed. And only the four new individuals, they get a new phenotypic value. Okay, then we still have to calculate the phenotypes for the new individuals. And again, we must make sure that the phenotypes of the old individuals remain the same. So we find out what are the new individuals. So they are the names that are present in the new genome file vector, because that contains BC1.2.4, but they are not yet present in the old phenoval vector, because that was calculated after the first run. And so if we calculate in this way, we easily get the new individuals. And indeed, if we print them, we see that it's only the four BC1 individuals. And the new phenotypic values then become a combination of the old phenotypic values for the first five individuals and new values calculated for the new individuals. And if we show them side by side, we see now nine individuals. And so the phenotypic values also are still the same as for the after the first run, which is as it should be, because they're still the same individuals. And the four new individuals, they also have been assigned phenotypic value. Well, this is in a nutshell how you can perform selection simulations. And of course, this was a very simple example. It was very small in the sense that it had a few individuals, it had a very simple genome, a very simple map. Also, there was a trait that was determined by just one locus in a very simple additive way. That can be, all of that can be done in a much more sophisticated way. For instance, the causal locus of the trait can be not biallelic, but multi-allelic, with different relations between the alleles. So some can work additively, but there could also be a dominant allele present or recessivity. So there is in pedigree sim R a function called locus.genovalue, which is one way that you can use to have a complicated control over the genotypic value based on a single locus. And apart from that, of course, there can be multiple trait loci that affect the same trait. And then again, the values determined by these loci can simply be added, or there can be epistatic interactions and so on. Again, the possibilities are endless, but all this is quite easily, because these relations are very simple to code in a few lines. So it's very simple to obtain the genotypic values of your individuals from the genotype, even if it's a rather complex relationship. And again, also the phenotype values, we just added the same environmental noise, in this case, in the two generations that we simulated. But that need not be the case, of course. You can have a more complex simulation of phenotypes involving effects of years or blocks or whatever experimental designs you have. And again, that's all this is something that you have to do outside of PedigreeSim. PedigreeSim just offers you the way to generate the population and obtaining genotypic values. And phenotypic values is something that is that you have to do within R, for instance. So we'll not explore those possibilities much further, but it's good to remember that the principles are always the same. So you start by simulating an initial population. From the genotypes of this population, you calculate genotypic values according to some model. And from the genotypic values, you obtain phenotypic values by adding noise from one or more sources. Then based on the phenotypic values, you can perform selection, or you can perform selection also based on some of the loci that you use as selectable markers. And you can, of course, also select based on progeny of individuals, et cetera, whatever you can do in your thing. Schemes you can also simulate. But in effect, you select individuals, you perform, you extend your pedigree with progeny of those crosses, and you run pedigree sim again, and then you repeat all the steps as often as needed to simulate your breeding scheme. So in this next example, we show show how this is done in a more extended way. But I won't skip that example for this workshop because we might run out of time otherwise. But well, this example is maybe interesting. It contains two traits that affect the same trait. One with two alleles that act in an additive way, just like we saw in the first example. And the other has three alleles, so and dominance as well as additivity plays a role there. We also simulate marker-aided selection for one of the two causal genes. And we compare two selection strategies in this example. One is only based on phenotypes, and the other is a combination of phenotypes and marker data. And then after two rounds of selection, we compare the average genotypic value of the selected individuals. And, I can already say that the marker-aided selection gives slightly better results. Well, but as I said, I'll skip this example for now, and we'll go on to a different subject. So all this is stiff for the second example. She saw two scenarios. Let's see where I'm. Okay. And that brings me to the next subject of this workshop, and that is the simulation of genotyping data. So in the example that we just skipped, we performed marker-based selection for one of the based on two marker loci. But there we used the true genotypes at those markers, and of course those true genotypes are not not available in general. We have to to determine them using some genotyping experiments. And genotyping experiments, they are prone to yield wrong data or missing data. So if you want to make your simulation more realistic, you can add the simulation of genotyping data for the marker loci that you are using for selection. So For instance, I would like to simulate something like a cusp marker. And here is a real life picture from potato. So this is one locus cusp assay. And we can see here in this population, five clusters more or less well defined for the nulliplex, simplex, duplex, triplex, and quadruplex dosages. But what we see, and what is of course quite common in genotyping experiments, is that there is not always a very clear distinction between those clusters. So there are individuals where it's doubtful whether they are, well, for instance, triplex or duplex. And in this case, there are also a number of individuals that have a very low signal intensity compared to the rest, where something probably went wrong, either with the DNA isolation or with the assay or whatever. So we have a number of missing data after such an experiment, and we have probably also a few errors if an individual that's actually quadruplex somehow ends up within the range of the triplex individuals. Okay, so we have two tools available here for simulating genotyping experiments. And the first tool, the main tool that I want to introduce to you is called GenoSim. GenoSim is a very versatile tool, and it has options to simulate either sequence reads or array type data. There are many parameters to make it as realistic as possible. For GenoSim, we need to produce, GenoSim is a tool that was developed by two of my colleagues, our PhD student Yanlin Yao and Giorgio Tumino. And it's available currently as a Shiny app on the server of Wageningen University and Research. And it's publicly available, so we can all use it. So GenoSim needs to start with files with the true dosages of the individuals for which we want to simulate genotyping data. Now, the true dosages we take from the second example that we skipped, but we have here a file, an allele dose file from that example, which is also present in the workshop materials. So we don't need to run that example now. So we read that file and get the dosages. And we obtain from that the two CSV files that we need, containing the dosages for two markers called A020 and A030. These are two markers that flank one of the causal loci in that example, which is at 25 centimorgan. So both of these flanking markers are 5 centimorgan distant. So as I said, it's a Shiny app, and you can access it through this website, which I'll open in a new tab, browser tab. So I hope you can see the Shiny web interface. When it opens, we open at the introduction tab. And we have several choices. So we can start to do dosage simulation. Well, in our case, that's not needed because we already have dosages. We can simulate a whole SNP array where the different markers are simulated with parameters according to some realistic distributions. Or we can obtain sequencing results for a lot of markers with parameters distributed in specific ways. In this case, we are interested in simulating one single marker. because we have those markers, the dosages of those markers available. And we just want to simulate for these two markers, the array data. So we are going to simulate array data because we want to mimic more or less the CASP marker. The other choice would be to simulate sequence reads, but we do not choose that. So we browse to upload one of these CSV files, for instance, the A020 that we just created. So upload is complete, and we can give here a name. Let's give the name of the marker. Then we have to set the parameters for the simulation. So what's the probability? It's already 4 by default, so we just use that. The overdispersion, which is a measure of how well the clusters are separated on the in the array simulation. Well, I want to make that a little bit bigger, to make the clusters less separated. There's allelic bias, which says how strong the one allele is versus the other. And this, the total intensity on average will be, this number, I don't know why it's there, but it's, let's just accept the defaults. If we take these values that we have now defined, we'll get something that looks like this. So we go then to the top sheet simulate and we perform the simulation. It's very fast. And then we can download a tar file. Now a tar file is something similar to a zip file. Meaning that it contains folders and files within those folders. So you download this file. And in this file, you will find several nested subfolders. So you go down all the way to the subfolder, to the last subfolder, and in that last subfolder, there is one file. Let me see where I can find it. What's the name? Oh yeah, this is the name of the tar file. It will get something like the day time and then the name that you had defined. I'm just looking at, oh yes, here this is it. So within this tar file, there is one file that we will need here, and that's called always genotype called template.csv. That's the file that contains our simulated X and Y signals. And furthermore, it's formatted in a way that is directly usable by the dosage calling software FitPoly. So we extract this file and we rename it. So let's rename it to something called like A020, the name of the marker, and then genosim.csv. And we get a similar file for the marker A30. So these files are in the format for FitPoly, but we also want to make an XY plot of the simulated data. And we want in this XY plot also to show the true genotypes. So we read this data file, one of them in this case, we add the true dosages in an extra column called dosage. And we take those true dosages from the allele dosage file that we downloaded, that we simulated and loaded. We do the same for the other marker. And for the FitPoly run later on, we combine the two into one big data frame just by R-binding them on top of each other. But first, we take a look at the simulation. And that looks like this, which is actually what we also saw already on the website of Genosim. But now the markers are, the individuals are colored and get a symbol according to their true genotype. So the nulliplexes, they get blue pluses, the ones get red pluses, and so on. In fact, there are only three different dosages in this population, 0, 1, and 2. And we see the three clusters that have been simulated, and they are still just separated. Although there are a few individuals where it might be not so clear to which cluster, to which dosage they belong. And for the A3, so these plots, by the way, they are generated by the function plotSimXY, which is also in the PedigreeSimR. So this is the other marker, and it has a very similar pattern. So this is all very nice, and GenoSim is it's a very realistic way of simulating marker data. But the drawback, at least at this moment, because we have to work through a website, is that it involves manual interaction. Yeah? So you have to upload files, have to download files, and to extract data from a tar file. So as an alternative, for the moment, I also wrote a very small function which is present in PedigreeSimR, which just performs a very simplistic array simulation. Cannot perform a sequence reads simulation. And so that also is demonstrated here. So again, for the first marker, we extract the dosages from the dosage file, the dosage for this marker. And we obtain the XY data, the simulated XY data, by calling function ArraySim with these dosages and the ploidy, and give the marker name. And then there are a few other parameters that are, bit harder to understand. They are explained in the help for this function. There is a mean signal intensity with a standard deviation, and there are background intensities for the X and the Y signal, also with a mean and a standard deviation. And there's also the strength of the Y signal versus the X, which is simulated here, so as the Y being only 0.4 times as strong as the X signal. And that gives us, for the same two markers for which we get the GenoSim simulation, it gives us, of course, somewhat different results because it's a different function. And in this case, you see that the clusters for the two markers, they overlap somewhat more than in the previous simulation. That's just a matter of choosing the parameters. So it is for one marker and it is for the other marker. In the case of these markers, of using the ArraySim function, we still need to convert the results to an input format for FitPoly, for the dosage coding software. And that's done with the function XY to FitPoly, where we give the XY data that have been simulated in the marker name and the dosages. So now actually we have, here we then, just like we did with the GenoSim simulation, we combine the simulated data of the two markers into one big file containing both, just by combining them one on top of the other. Well, finally, we perform dosage calling with FitPoly in this case, and FitPoly is one of the dosage calling software that we have been seeing in the previous workshop a year ago. So if it's not installed, we can check whether it's installed with the find package command, and if it's not, we need to install it. It's on CRAN. And then once it's installed, we can use the save marker models function in that package, where we specify the PLOID and the data either from GenoSim here or in the next command. It's for the ArraySim data. And we give some additional parameters that have been discussed in the last workshop, which I'm not going to repeat here. So PedigreeSim runs, and we can retrieve the dosages from the output file. So for the GenoSim simulated arrays, we get the GS calls by reading this output file, gs_dot. And for the ArraySim simulation, we get it from the as_dot file. And then we tabulate the called dosages versus the true dosages. And this is, of course, one of the nice things that you can do when you have simulated data, because you always know the true values. And so that you can see how well your dosage calling returns the actual data. So if we look at the data from GenoSim first, we tabulate the called dosages versus the true dosages. So we use the table command of R. So we tabulate the GenoSim calls, the fit body calls of the GenoSim data for the marker A20 versus the true dosages of marker A20. And so this is what you see in the rows are the dosage calls, in the columns are the true dosages. You see that it's very close, except that there are two individuals that receive a no call. These are probably the two individuals that I highlighted in the XY plot earlier. And for the A30, again, we see a very close correspondence with a few more no calls. And for the ArraySim, where the simulation showed a bit more overlap between the clusters, we see a few more problems. So again, the majority of the calls is correct, so 0, 0, 1, 1, 2, 2. But there are a few error calls. So here are two individuals that have been called as 1, but have a true dosage of 0. And there are quite a number of missing data here. And similarly for the other marker. So this is, something that you of course see in practice. Some of the genotyping results are incorrect or are missing. And of course that can have an impact on our selection. And whether that would be the case in example 2 is something that you can try out if you actually use this example. So I'm getting to the end. There's two references that I would like to highlight. One is a reference from Peter Voss, who studied linkage disequilibrium in potato, looking at the potato varieties of different ages, so varieties from the 19th century and from before the Second World War, from before 1970 and after. These linkage disequilibriums, we were able to simulate with quite simple assumptions using PedigreeSim that described in this first reference. And second reference is the original reference to the PedigreeSim program. As you can see from the title, it says here diploid and tetraploid organisms. But since then, the program has been extended. It now will simulate any even ploidy level. And also some other niceties have been added in the meantime. And as I said, it's still being developed. So from time to time, there will be further updates. And I'd like to end with acknowledging, of course, the SCRI project, which made this possible. And where I'm very happy that I'm able to give this workshop. And also there is a TKI project in the Netherlands, which is a private-public partnership involving quite a lot of breeding companies in ornamentals and potatoes and vegetables, where we have a very nice collaboration with these partners. And with that, I would like to end, and I'll take questions. And also, I will be available during the lunch break at 12 o'clock. Thank you.